keep time during our sessions. And yesterday we tried, so today as well we will try as much as possible. And to note that we have a lot of seats on this side, so if you're missing a seat, please don't sit on the periphery. We have enough seats on this side. And just to check whether the translation is working, and I'm trying to check anyone that is wearing headsets to confirm that the translation is working. Just looking around the room. Working okay? Okay. We have a few announcements as we prepare to begin. And if the technical team can help me with the announcement for the TJNA at 15. So the Tax Justice Network Africa, or TJNA, is now 15 years old. I had a wow. Is now 15 years old. And we are lucky and happy to announce that the team that is here today will be joining us in a big birthday party later this evening. Can I hear a wow? And the TJNA team, as well as the volunteers, will be helping us with that. But we want you to clear your plans for the evening. If you had an awesome plan for the evening, we have given you a better and more awesome plan to join us. So please cancel your plans, send that email, send that WhatsApp. We will have an evening together as we celebrate TJNA at 15. In addition to that, I'm reminded that if you if you need a PCR test in preparation for your travel, our team at the front desk will help you, because there's going to be the people who do the testing coming around later today, around the break time. So you just need your passport details, and the team at the front desk can be able to help you with your PCR test if you need one for your travel. In addition to that, please check with the reception if you have bills that you signed against your room, so that you can clear them over time, so that your checkout will be smooth. That's what I'm reminded. I'm also reminded that if we helped you to organize your travel, therefore, if you know Xavier, who is our man on the ground, who has been helping with the travel, kindly, during the course of the day today, ensure that you speak to either the TJNA team or the front desk team, so that they can connect you to Xavier, so that we can help you to prepare for your departure, including things like taxi and any other thing that you might need in preparation for your departure. Yeah, there are those, I'm being reminded that he's Xavier, but he doesn't speak French. There are those who call him Xavier, but he's Xavier, and he insists to be called Xavier. Yeah. In addition to that, we want to know whether you slept well. You slept well, you had a good night? You had a good night? This side, they didn't sleep well. Did we trouble you too much? Yeah, and just to hear from two or three people about your reflections from yesterday, because I know you went into breakaways, and we had an awesome day yesterday. If there's anyone who wants to speak about their reflections or things that stood out from them for them from yesterday, going once, going twice, we have the Honorable Shabalala on this side. Any other hand, going once, going twice, maybe we can hear from you, Honorable, as we... yes.
Thank you, Francis. I think for me what stood out is the, because my issue was how is European to produce pan-European question further than produce neo-fascists in the last 15 years. And I think the response was we don't have synergy in terms of our training and education. Therefore, our viewpoints to any particular topic differ. So what stood out for me was that need for, I would say, in quotes, political grounding, you know, that makes us move from sort of one ideology. I suppose we had that in the 40s, 50s, in the run-up to the liberation movement in terms of pan-Africanism, but I think, yes, we did lose it over the years, truly speaking. So maybe I took that as a solution, and I took that as something that I truly want to champion and take it forward. Thank you.
Yeah, emancipating ourselves. And I remember some, I think it was Titus who was saying that even within the civil society movement and even within governments themselves, you have different viewpoints on the same issues, and people need that kind of grounding for us to be able to move forward together. Any other reflections? The beauty is that I know a lot of you in the room. So I can be able to call you by name. Somebody like Celine. Celine, well, reflections from yesterday. So it's best for you to volunteer before I volunteer you. Celine, reflections from yesterday, then we'll come to you, Mutuso. I see your hand. Yeah, and I think I heard it clearly said on this stage that we need to move from a Washington consensus to a Southern consensus. We'll go to Mutuso, then we'll go to my brother back there.
Thank you very much, Francis. I think yesterday was great, being a Pan-Africanist, and at times it makes you wonder to say, with all this critical thinking that is there on these issues, where do we get it wrong as Africans? And because when we speak, you could tell that the understanding is there, the vision is there. But why is it not happening? I think that's the biggest question that we were left hanging on. And it was listening to Titus, listening to another speaker, in that yes, we all understand where the problems are going by and what needs to be done. So why are we not doing it? Of course, we as lawyers, we felt that we are being dominated by economists, and we also have advantage of our voice there in terms of the legal aspects of these issues. But apart from that, I think it was a day that actually helped us to have a deeper understanding of these issues, and thanks to Texas Network Africa for continuing to bring us together to reflect on these very important issues. Thank you.
Yeah, brother, and one last hand if there's anyone else who wants to comment before we get into the program for the day. And please introduce yourself, sir.
Good morning. My name is Larry Liza. I serve as the director of the World Customs Organization in Eastern Southern Africa. What I saw yesterday was the thirst of the civil society for a better world and a better Africa, and sometimes us in government, you close yourself and you think that you are doing everything you can, but that you are doing everything, you know, and just being here, seeing that there is greater coordination among the others who may not necessarily be in government, and they are doing a lot more. When people had to go to the breakaway stations, the room that had government, specifically customs, I think had the fewer people left behind. So it means more people from the civil society, from the private sector left for the other areas, and there are very few people left in customs. So I think I just saw that sometimes you can stay in a silo and think that you are doing that you need to do for a better world, but there is need for enhanced collaboration between government and the private sector and the others. Thank you.
Thank you. We have Mr. Mbalambala. And if you want to do it in French, it's still okay.
Okay.
Yes. So get your headsets ready, everyone. Today the it's working.
Bonjour, everybody. Ce que j'ai commenté que je peux faire, c'est okay?
No, it's fine. Yeah.
Le commentaire que je peux faire, qui repose sur la discussion que nous avons commencée hier, c'est la comparaison que l'un des orateurs a développée entre la Chine comme un pays et l'Afrique comme un continent aujourd'hui. Il a bien illustré en présentant une image telle qu'un pays comme le Cameroun d'où je viens, dans les années 60-70, apportait de l'aide à la Chine et à l'Occident pourri. Mais aujourd'hui, c'est l'inverse. Et lorsque nous parlons de la taxation de la fiscalité de notre économie n'a pas du tout bougé, n'a pas du tout bougé depuis ces années. Et nous voyons très bien que nous avons des difficultés. We are exploiting the foreign resources and can't exploit our national resources. As far as I'm concerned, my time I've kept is that we as Africans, we should be able to move, we should now move to the implementation so that we are able to transform our natural resources, and that is going to help us to spread to widen the basis for the tax. I call upon the social society, I mean the civil society, to really pressurize, to actually talk to the government so that we are able to add value to what we exploit, add value before we can export it to the outside world. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Mbalambala. Chinedu, the last one.
Thank you, Francis. My name is Chinedu. I am from Nigeria. One major thing that stood out for me yesterday is the fact that there is a new definition that tax is more political right now. And also to keep it aside, the fact that tax is still technical. So the question is, how do we take the technicality into the political arena? Because at the end of the day, the politicians let people sign off. And if technicality is excluded, we keep complaining about the results at the end of the day.
Thank you, thank you. I think we will get there in terms of the reflections, but just to remind you something about yesterday. Yesterday we had, at the peak of this room, 170 participants. We had 21 countries represented. I think that's awesome. For today, we want to create more opportunities for you to also input. And therefore, our sessions today are planned in a way that we will also keep drawing from your experiences. I want to draw your attention to a few changes that happened to the first session of the day because of complications with travel. And I know we were expecting to have a few people there, but we will have Tulani from ETAF moderating the session. And then we will have Mr. Shelton Chigumira from ZIMRA, that is the Zimbabwean Revenue Authority, as one of the panelists. We will also have Mr. Martin Chileshe, who is an assistant director at ZRA, or the Zambia Revenue Authority. And then we will have Laila from the University of Nairobi Committee on Fiscal Studies, who is online and following us. And after that, we will go for a break around 10:30. And then we will go into three breakaways. The three breakaways are exactly as featuring on your program. We will have one breakaway in this room, and then one breakaway will be in a room that is outside this door, and then one other breakaway will be in a room that is near the reception that we used yesterday. But we will announce that before we go for break. After that, we will go for lunch after our breakaways, and then we will come back for one last session of the day. And after that last session, we will go into the closing ceremony. So today is not going to be a long day as yesterday. And then after that, we will invite you to join TJNA as we celebrate our 15th birthday. For those who have just walked into the room, we came up with a Southern consensus to cancel every other plan for the evening and join TJNA in celebrating TJNA at 15. I want to invite Tulani, who will be chairing this session, to take us forward. Tulani, welcome.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, honorable members, fellow colleagues. I'm going to invite my panelists, Shelton and Martin. And then also I would like to check if Layla can hear us, and are you online? And then please can I request the technical team to project the presentation. So colleagues, welcome to session three of the program. This morning we'll be looking at innovative ways in which we can mobilize domestic resources and look at critical areas where countries have actually had success in mobilizing domestic resources. I think yesterday we heard a lot about some of the concerns and the challenges that countries have, and today we want to explore some of the advantages that countries have and some of the areas in which we believe that other countries can replicate and illustrate success. So we're going to go through this session. Firstly, we'll start with a presentation just to paint the picture of some of the policy interventions, some of the areas in which countries could consider focusing in addressing those innovative DRM strategies. And then lastly, we showcase some positive results that have come through. And then the panelists will also share some of their experiences, and I hope that I can invite you all as well in engaging with the panelists and sharing your successes and your ideas in advancing policy. If you can assist me with the next slide, colleagues. Thank the next one. No. This is sorry, Brian. This is not my presentation. But I'll continue speaking. Yesterday we listened to the enablers of IFF, and from a revenue administration point of view, one of the issues that we've spotted is that companies tend to exploit loopholes. There are a number of areas that can be improved, where we believe that they are low-hanging fruit, and countries can address these issues through innovative tax policy adjustments. And one of those areas, like I said, is interest payments. Excessive interest means that companies will reduce their profits by paying a large amount of interest on loans, on intercompany loans. By reducing this profit, it means that you don't pay tax. You remember, you don't pay tax if you don't make profit. So that's one of the strategies that we've seen, and it's quite aggressive, especially in the extractives and mining sectors, where you've got a group of companies that tend to do business by among each other. There's a number of subsidiaries. So if, for example, in your countries, if you think about a mining operation, you find that the mining company is from Australia, but it bought out a local subsidiary to do some operations in the mine, and then it also bought out another local subsidiary to do marketing and selling of the products, and then it's bought out another subsidiary to do technical advice. And so by doing that, you then have this this area of multiple interconnected companies doing business among each other, and of course exploiting those areas. Then the other area that we've noticed on aggressive pricing is taking advantage of different rates in different countries, setting up operations in different countries to ensure that you can take advantage of that. Next slide, please. So we shouldn't be too saddened, if I could call it that. There's a number of continental developments that are currently taking place in terms of bringing us to where we are. The African Union has recently set up what's called the Subcommittee on Tax and IFFs, and it's an important subcommittee because it also invites private individuals to participate who've got the technical experience to participate in the subcommittee in shaping some of these areas. There's also work that's taking place, as the ECA has mentioned, on measuring tax expenditure, on measuring illicit financial flows in the country. There's also areas like UNCTAD, where they are providing large statistical data pools that can be addressed. So from a DRM point of view, there's all of these areas that we can mobilize in terms of creative strategy. One other area around tax policy, sorry, previous slide. One other area in terms of tax policy is adjusting regulatory spaces. What do we mean by this? There are areas that just need a small tweak, and they will result in additional revenue. Just a small adjustment. It could be wording in a regulation. It could be an introduction in regulation. For example, if you look at point number two, we're saying have penalty regimes for non-compliance. If you want to test the systems and the legality, you will be caught out and you will be appropriately punished. Now, many of our countries don't have sufficient penalty regimes. You find that these were set in the 1970s and in the 80s, and they're very dated. And companies will take their chances in aggressive pricing. We should introduce regular practice notes to update taxpayers. And then we should also look at treaty network. Our treaties are also outdated and very limited. So we don't share a lot of information as African jurisdictions. And then lastly, continue on the capacity building. Could I have the next slide? We must also promote transparency in the fact that, like I said, sharing information. You can see in the slide we're saying that 70% of African countries have exchange of information units, and only 86% of countries have a delegated competent authority. This is the office that is in charge of exchanging information between jurisdictions. And only 5 countries have automatic exchange of information. So there's great progress that's been made, but there's still areas. That 5 countries is a concern. I know some of our member countries are working at increasing this. Kenya, Rwanda are on the footpath to increasing that number. But also you can see that We're improving on the number of requests that are sent and the number of requests that are being received. So it shows you that there is something working. There is a consciousness to address some of these IFF challenges by requesting and receiving information. May I have the next slide, please? Now, before I turn to my panelists, I thought we should paint out some of the successes that have taken place. I'm going to actually start the conversation here by looking at our host country, Zambia. Zambia has improved its tax collection, and it's improved its revenue mobilization because it's done a number of adjustments. Martin will tell us about Section 97A, which is the new transfer pricing regulations that have come into effect, and there's great success there. And then you can see that this has translated into an immediate pickup of $40 million from one singular company. Additionally, there are other elements that were, for this case to get there, there are other elements like exchange of information, the adjustment to policy framework, the new regulations that resulted in that. Also, there's a 13 million Pula case again in Botswana, where it's about a small adjustment to the regulation that forces the company to comply. And lastly, in Senegal, we've seen that the new interest deductibility laws and the new guidance and regulation on indirect transfer of assets is helping compliance. Companies are now aware that you cannot move your assets indirectly and then claim credits elsewhere. So these are some of the initiatives. Just to kick us off in the discussion, so that we can have a feedback session from the participants as well. Now I'm going to check once again if Layla is online. Layla, are you there? Can you hear us? Thank you, Layla. I'm going to ask you to speak up a little, but to get us started and to get your perspective on things, take us through some of the areas around policy reform, some of the innovative areas that you've seen around policy reform, and how these areas can translate into additional revenue, but also innovative domestic resource mobilization strategies.
Okay, thank you. Am I loud enough?
Yes, you are.
Perfect. So, good morning, everybody. It's really a pity I'm not there in person, but, you know, we're here and we're going to engage. So, Fudani, I'm glad that you posed this question, you know, regarding innovative policy reforms that are needed towards enhancing DRM and fiscal capacity of our African states. Now, I am certain that our audience, right, will agree that most, if not all, African budgets are actually financed through borrowing. Now, the effect of this is that the African fiscal space then suffers from the problem of intertemporal budget constraints, which means that any debt outstanding today must be and will be offset by a future source of revenue. So if we to think about mobilizing and earmarking the revenue needed tomorrow to pay for the debts of today, this is the job of a responsibly designed tax policy, right? An innovative tax policy. So if we're going to be speaking about policy reform that is needed to accelerate progressive economic growth post-COVID-19, stop its financial flows and prevent base erosion and profit shifting, so as to sustain the African fiscal basket in order to, you know, cushion consumer price indices from inflation, then our policymakers and our civil society should really rethink their stand on tax incentives. So this is what I want to talk about, right? Tax incentives are nothing but drivers of fiscal drawbacks. Since revenue were grown from not taxing corporations could have been the revenue needed tomorrow to pay the debts of today. We all know right, that tax incentives do not really lead to investments. But we still have this problem about our tax policies, which are always designed to include these tax incentives. So we really need to think about what do we need to do about these issues. Even the OECD and the IMF have confirmed this. What is absolute is that tax incentives strip revenue from the state. And if we evaluate offering of tax incentives against the current fiscal capacity of African states, which is causing governments to implement austerity measures, reduce social spending so as to service their debts, and at the same time increase the burden of taxation on citizens, we really, really must then consider innovative policy reform measures around tax incentives. This is important and necessary, also because tax incentives, according to how they are characterized, basically their forms are drivers of illicit financial flows undermining development. So you are now probably curious on whether there have been innovations in tax policy on incentives across Africa. So I'd like to share with you quickly some experiences that we have accumulated. So currently, we are in the midst of finalizing a case study report on Chad, the Democratic Republic of Congo, Equatorial Guinea, and Nigeria, where we are evaluating the cost and benefit analysis of tax treaties and trying to propose what I hope are innovative solutions that provide a justified balance between offering tax incentives and advancing towards a progressive and responsible tax system. Now, this report is actually, under the auspices and funded by Oxfam International. It is guided by Yusumu Kasheshe, who I think is part of the audience today. So the preliminary findings out of this are as follows. First, think about this. Approximately $255 million was foregone in revenue based on the tax incentives that were given by DRC. And these are the statistics which are latest available as for 2018. They have been reported by the Global Tax Expenditures Database. Now compare this amount that has been lost with $363 million DRC borrowed from IMF. If it wasn't for the tax incentives given, the request for loan would have significantly reduced. Equatorial Guinea in 2019 lost $34 million. During this period, the IMF also authorized an initial disbursement of $14 million to Equatorial Guinea to reduce its macroeconomic imbalances. If it wasn't for the tax incentives given, Equatorial Guinea would only have needed about $6 million as loan instead of 40. Nigeria, right, in 2020 lost $16 billion from tax incentives. Now compare this with $837 million, which is needed annually to reduce child malnutrition. So clearly there is a need for policy reform on tax incentives. They are not fit for purpose. The revenue that these states have lost, taking into account the current advent of constricted DRM, means that tax incentives are actually a fiscal crisis issue, right? So the problem right now, if we think about repo, is that tax incentives cannot entirely be abolished because initial startup support is needed for enterprises, to help mitigate costs. However, some innovation or tight monitoring and evaluation of tax incentives is needed. And our report, which we hope to publish by the end of October, tackles some of these policy proposals. We make about 7 recommendations, but I only talk about 2. First, our African government should really rethink their approach to tax incentives. These incentives should be subject to the legislative process. It should be consolidated under the tax law and not negotiated through treaties, contracts, or other parallel domestic fiscal regimes. And the approval process of tax incentives should involve public participation. This is not happening in DRC, Equatorial Guinea, Nigeria, and Chad. It must. It also has to be consolidated under the authority of the Minister of Finance and enforced and monitored by the Revenue and you know, data can play a significant role in this. Secondly, I think one of the proposals that we put forward is that the granting of tax incentives should be based on rules rather than discretion, right? We observe that in Equatorial Guinea, in Chad, for example, the minister for who's responsible for the extractive sector would, at his discretion, offer an incentive. And at the same time, the Minister of Agriculture would offer an incentive for agricultural companies, right? This is not founded on law, but a discretion, and we know that discretion is problematic. So some of the recommended rules for any mining company, for example, right, to benefit from tax incentives in Africa is that at the preliminary stage, what we're proposing, that is hopefully an innovative approach, is that a mine feasibility study should be conducted, which relates to number one, give us the production and price forecasts. Secondly, tell us what the mine planning process is going to look like to maximize the return on investments. Now here you get to understand how the multinational corporation is or will be structured so that, you know, any possible aggressive tax planning factors can be detected. This is very, very crucial, right? Maybe the MNC is being set up as a conduit to manage credit transfer crisis. We need to get this information at the start before our governments go ahead and issue out an incentive. And then our governments need to look at comparative price assessment with World Bank pink sheets, right? So for example, Equatorial Guinea is a net producer of hydrocarbon gas. Now, as part of hydrocarbon gas policy, the government of Equatorial Guinea should think about pricing its hydrocarbon gas in such a way that, you know, we need to figure out at the start, initially, what would be the pricing formula for hydrocarbon gas liquid. Is this price renegotiated as per the investment treaty? Is it to be subject to double taxation, or is it to be compared with World Bank pink sheets? It's very crucial to get this right before any tax incentive is issued by any African government. Our government and also civil society should push any company that is seeking to benefit from a tax incentive to project their depreciation schedule in advance. Let them not say this is not possible because this can be based on set accounting standards. We also need to really look at the regime of tax incentives justified. Why do we need them? For what purposes? Should we just provide them to those companies that are going to actually help in implementing SDGs and, you know, support climate mitigation and adaptation strategies? And at the same time, we've got to be able to assess in advance what are the economic benefits of the incentive granting scheme. So, Dan, this is where I'd like to stop in terms of the proposals that we hope to make in terms of supporting a stronger regime to mitigate the abuses that occur as a result of, you know, blatant tax incentives that have been given. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much, Leila. I think one of the issues that you've highlighted around tax incentives is the expenditure part. And then additionally, as you've said, both IMF and OECD have said that this might not be the best way to go. I'm going to come back to you, and when we can unpack the issue of tax incentives in the Pillar 2 regime that I think might make African countries rethink their policy strategies around tax incentives, because there's potential losses that will be visible. I'm going to turn my attention now to Shelton. Just following up on the discussion around tax incentives and also linking it to the issues around interest payments. These are stripping out the value in companies. What are some of the areas that you've seen that are, one, problematic, two, where can we develop solutions, and three, what other additional support do you think countries need? Over to you, Shelton.
Thank you, Jalan. Yeah, I'm glad that you are talking about the issue of tax incentives, either of the Pillar 2 proposals, you will realize that what Pillar 2 is proposing is that there's a minimum tax which these agencies will be charged worldwide. So if you should introduce tax incentives to an AMC, you realize that as much as you have allowed them to be taxed in your jurisdiction, you are simply surrendering the taxing rights to another jurisdiction. They would simply apply the limitation rules that that are against by the minimum tax and ensure that they collect the tax. So, in short, providing tax incentives if these Pillar 2 proposals are adopted is essentially surrendering your taxing rights to another jurisdiction. So this in itself means that we may need to rethink our position on whether we are really benefiting anything in as far as providing these tax incentives or not. So I believe that if we do have the incentives in place, and maybe in preparation for the introduction of the Pillar 2 proposals, we probably have to go and revisit those and possibly change them before the Pillar 2 proposals are put into effect.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. If effectively countries are now going to, you're going to lose the income, as Leila pointed out. She pointed out that the DRC has lost out $255 million in a series of tax incentives. Now, let's assume that there's a mining operation of three foreign entities. The DRC has the potential of losing additionally. They won't see that income because that foreign entity will have the right to tax that income up to 15%. So effectively, countries are going to be losing twice over, if you think about it. So that 255 million from DR Congo might actually be more. It might be double. Or we can assume that at least at a minimum, it will be 15% of the income, of the profit income of that MNC. But perhaps let me ask Martin, what are some of the areas that you've seen at ZRA that might pose challenges in collecting revenue, particularly in areas where you find that there are some tax incentives? And additionally, what is the tax incentive regime in the mining sector? Because we know there's a lot of mining activity in Zambia, but also are there other tax incentives that you're struggling in terms of getting revenue from companies? Thanks.
Thank you very much, Duran, for that question. Yeah, the issue of tax incentives, as Shelton highlighted, when the implementation of Pillar 2 is fully done, it means that most countries that are implementing these tax incentives will lose out on the much needed revenues for their countries. Because there is a rule that they are calling the subject to tax rule, where if in the source country they have not applied the minimum tax due to tax incentives, then the rights will be given to where the multinational is the parent company's resident for them to have the right to tax before the source country. So in one way or another, you find that country will be losing out. So in terms of our mining sector in Zambia, and with respect to tax incentives, initially we had a number of tax incentives that were given to the mining sector, especially when we were at the time when we had privatized most of the mining companies. So we needed the investment. So we brought in a lot of companies that invested in the mining sectors, and of course we had to give them some tax incentives. At the moment, we have been able to remove most of these tax incentives, and most of the companies are paying tax. Of course, we have one or two tax incentives still remaining in the area of maybe dividends, where mining companies paying out dividends to shareholders for any profits that they realize. Then those dividends may not be subjected to tax in the first 5 years of operations of that entity. Then recently, we have had to allow the deductibility of mineral tax as an expense from the income that is realized by these companies. The reason is this is what globally is happening. Because the mineral tax is more or less like an expense. So we have had to conform with what is happening in Cambodia, where we have allowed these tax incentives. However, just to explain most of the tax incentives have been phased out progressively.
Yeah, so at least colleagues, we're seeing that there is some effort that's been taken to limit the amount of tax incentives, because from a revenue collection experience, it can be very difficult to go and provide an assessment to a multinational. So the audit teams would provide an assessment, and then they get to the taxpayer, and the taxpayer starts to disqualify some of those areas in the assessment because there's a tax incentive in place. Now, Leila spoke about the opaqueness of these, where you've got different ministers in one country offering a series of incentives that don't speak to one another, but perhaps speak to one portfolio of operation in that country. And that creates this level of confusion and erodes the tax base. I'm going to come back to our panelists, but I do want to check the temperature in the room for questions that you'd like to pose or some suggestions that you'd like to make and add to that to the discussion. So I'm going to stop speaking for now and see if there are any hands that want to pose questions or make inputs. All right, I see one, two. All right, I'm going to start with Madame De. Thank you. Thank you. Yes, the gentleman over here. Thank you. Yes, Matthew.
crimes and the like, and also giving highlights, statistics on some of our enforcement operations and what, you know, errant taxpayers do to try and avoid or evade tax. So that kind of changed the spectrum and the perspective that they had had. And I can tell you that progressively since then, we moved from a situation where we had, I think, about 50% of decisions going against us to now an average of between 86 to 90% success rate in court. And that's a constant now. So that's really helped. And I think that, something that could be helpful for other countries when necessary. Thank you.
Yeah, that is very encouraging. You've heard from Uganda. I think that is something that we, as countries, we can replicate. Matthew's here. I think we can engage with him and see how we can replicate that in other countries. I do know that in Kenya, for example, around the judiciary, there is a tax tribunal. And there's been attempts as well to assist in appreciating the value that judges play in mobilizing domestic resources. I'm gonna give my panelists as well an opportunity, but I've seen two hands in the audience. I'm gonna start with my sister at the back, then I'll come to you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Mine is also related to the issue of using the courts. But this is particularly recognizing the work that we are doing as civil society organizations within the tax justice discourse. And usually what we have realized, I come from Zimbabwe, is that the tax incentives are arbitrary and border around actually being illegal in terms of overriding certain institutions or government bodies. Particularly for us, it's parliament, where some of the foreign agreements that the president or the minister makes have to go through parliament, but this has not been happening. So they become arbitrary and in some way unconstitutional and illegal. And I just wanted to find out, particularly maybe from Laila and the other panelists, in terms of opportunities also for us as civil society, because we're pushing for domestic resource mobilization. We have shown the gaps. We're giving the recommendations, as Laila has indicated, but how do we make our advocacy work through the courts as well, public interest litigation it could be. We've tried this, but it's also very tricky. I know there's one case that we were trying and realized that there will be a foreign organization or investor. Then there's a local, it's kind of a joint venture, and you never really get to know because of the secrecy and the opaqueness of these contracts in terms of, so who was given the tax incentive. So it's very dicey and difficult to engage in, but how do we also become innovative as part of the stakeholders in terms of pushing for domestic resource mobilization as civil society? Thank you.
Thanks very much. The gentleman at the back.
Thank you very much. Well, the question I want to put across is what happens when the discretionary powers lies in the hands of one man? For instance, in Ghana, we had issues with the incentives bill, and then from 2017, we started pushing for the passage of the bill. It goes to parliament, it comes back, it goes to parliament, it comes back. Just last, this year, we've been able to push for the passage of the bill. Now, one of the recommendations that we were looking at tackling was the issue of a power lying in the hands of the minister. Because sometimes they use those powers to get foreign direct investments. How do we ensure that with regards to this, there are transparency and incentives are not given to multinationals who don't need them, whereas the locals who need them don't get it? What happens when their powers are always in the hands of those authorities?
Yeah, thanks for that question. I'm going to take the last two, then we get the panel to respond, and then I'll open the floor up again. Joab.
Thanks. Mine is a brief one, and it's more related on how we organize at the national level in terms of government, and whether that facilitates what you're talking about how we structure, for example, our cabinets. And just from the experience of Zambia, I wanted to understand whether there's been, whether there is a coordinating unit, for example, between the Zambia Revenue Authority, the Ministry of Finance, the Ministry of Mines and Minerals Development, the Ministry of Commerce, Trade and Industry, because these are all key players in the discussion that we are having now, and whether, you know, who should have the ultimate, who should be making the ultimate decision when it comes to granting tax incentives. Thanks.
Thank you. Yes.
Thanks, Tilan. Would you say that tax incentives are the main driver of IFFs for African economies? I know that we say the mineral resources sector is, you know, where the largest happen, but are they happening because of tax incentives in that sector? Also, would you say there is a correlation between economies that emit the highest IFFs in the continent and the granting of tax incentives?
I think you've just given us a research topic there. So anyone who's enrolled in a master's program, there's your supervisor. All right, I love this debate because it's throwing out so many questions, so many things to think about, so many ideas as well. So I am going to take one more question as well.
Thank you, Tulani. My question is twofold. One, I would want to find out, just from your experiences, the extent to which government ministries do consult each other before offering tax incentives. And the last question is the extent to which most of the African governments undertake research to inform their decisions to offer incentives.
Yeah, thank you very much. Those are very clear and precise questions, and they're actually very short, so, but they require us to give some serious thought. Leila, can you kindly assist us in answering some of these questions? Let's start with the one around opportunities that lie in mobilizing domestic resources through the use of civil society organizations in country. And how they can work with various agencies of government, and of course academia, in mobilizing domestic resources, and also if you can answer any other question that you feel is relevant.
Of the political settings within which our states play an international role, and the international forces also influence our domestic policy. There is the role of the private sector. There are the lobbyists, the multinational corporations that will dictate to states, put diplomatic pressure, for example, on issuance of tax incentives. Another gentleman talked about the discretionary power. We observe this in Equatorial Guinea, where unfortunately we have a very strong president there. And most of the tax, most of the companies in Equatorial Guinea are you know, owned by the ruling elite who give themselves tax incentives. So one way in which the civil society can come together to counter these issues is by pushing for a domestic tax policy. I think when a country defines for itself what its fiscal policy is going to be, taking into account the social contract, taking into account the recent developments around SDGs, and also the move towards, you know, strengthening human rights in the country, we really need to have a tax policy that discusses the concept of progressive tax systems, in which tax incentives do not form part of a, you know, a core basket within which our taxation system is organized. Kenya recently passed its national tax policy, and in it, it was very clear that, you know, the Minister of Finance will be able to provide tax incentives. I think we also need to really think about a sort of a tax policy at the continental level, which can be then translated into domestic tax policies where tax incentives do not feature as a core part of the tax system. We also need to take the Kenyan example as a model, whereby we have a constitution that lays down certain principles, very strong principles on public finance, right? That revenue must be accountable, transparent. It must lead to sustainable development. And we have to be able to map the justification of these tax incentives onto certain national constitutional principles. This way, we safeguard against discretionary, arbitrary, and abusive powers that offer tax incentives. So I think this is what I would probably want to say, looking at it from a legal perspective. Let's have strong policies that condemn these practices, and let's create a framework within which we're going to be able to govern our decisions on whether to provide tax incentives or not, you know, in accordance with some of the recommendations I had talked about, you know, when I was earlier giving my talk. I hope I've answered some of the questions.
Yeah, most certainly. I actually picked something, and I thought let me also take the opportunity to ask you sort of like a position question. Do you think that countries that are not members of the inclusive framework might be incentivized to join in order to take advantage of the qualified minimum domestic top-up tax option? Do you think that might be a motivating factor for countries to join?
You know, I'd probably want to answer this as a lawyer. It would really depend because, you know, not everybody is happy with the OECD model. Many countries, most of the civil societies are inclined towards accepting the UN model tax convention. So perhaps the arguments for a discussion on tax competition, tax incentives would be better suited under the UN model. But if that is not feasible in the long run, then there could be a sort of a conditional approach to joining the IF to take advantage of the QDMTT, which would really help some of these countries in as much as they're providing tax incentives to also then counter or do a roundabout on their policy and say, you've made excessive profits, we're going to tax those excessive profits. But you know, it's a debatable issue. It's a hot topic.
Yes, indeed. I'm gonna turn my attention to Martin and Shelton. Just can you give us some feedback on some of the questions that were posed to you? I'll start with Martin. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Tulan, for the opportunity. Yeah, really, when you look at the questions that have been posed, maybe just to answer some of them, the question on whether tax incentives are the main drivers to the illicit financial flows. So, as you highlighted, this could be a research question indeed. But from my point of view, I think that tax incentives are not the main drivers of illicit financial flows. What are the main incentives to these financial flows? In my view, are the tax avoidance schemes that are prevalent in most of these countries. As you know, tax avoidance is not a, it's not illegal. It's just a way in which companies take advantage of the loopholes in the legislations, and then they take advantage and are able to siphon money through these schemes. And one of the schemes that has been highlighted is the transfer pricing. Transfer pricing is a tax avoidance scheme that many companies are using to BEPS erode the tax base of many companies. So in my view, what we need to do to ensure that we close up these gaps that allow for illicit financial flows such as transfer pricing, we need as African countries to ensure that we implement legislative changes like you highlighted in your presentation. There is need for legislative changes so that we can regulate the transfer pricing legislation to ensure that companies are able to be guided in what they need to submit in terms of their expectations, in terms of keeping documentation, TP documentation, and there should be also punitive penalties for not abiding by these regulations. There is also need for capacity building. Capacity building has played a very important role in our country, as Zambia, where now, because we have collaborated with ATAF and OECD, we have been able to have so many officers who have been trained in terms of technical capabilities to identify these loopholes that are inherent in the transfer pricing, these schemes. So capacity building for our officers is very, 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 very important. And also there was something that was mentioned in terms of our judges, capacity building for our judges, and to enlighten them on the area of these schemes such as transfer pricing. Because as you know, transfer pricing is a complex area and it's not cast on stone. So even judges, they find it difficult to get the grips of what is required or what is needed in order to, you know, make a judgment for that matter. For example, in Zambia, we recently had a case where on one hand, the judges were able to agree with the characterization of an entity by Zambia Revenue Authority to say, yes, this entity is a low-risk distributor. And at the same time, then they refused to say that you cannot use the TNN method on this type of company. So that's a conflicting statement in one way or another. Because where you see a company which is a low-risk distributor, you are able to use the whole entity approach through the use of the TNNM method. So you can see that even judges, they need to have this enlightenment so that they know what is required. And I agree with my brother, that the brother from Uganda, who said that they have been organizing these conferences for our judges to enlighten them about transfer pricing and so on. But when you look at the nature of the people we deal with, the judges, it's very difficult for a taxman, for example, to organize a workshop for judges. So it's organizations such as ATAF who can come up with these deliberate programs where they maybe come to Zambia and maybe train Supreme Court judges or High Court judges and enlighten them on the transfer pricing issues and BEPS eroding schemes. That way, they will get it better from an independent person rather than from within the country. So in terms of the other question, which talks about whether we do coordinate between these agencies of the government, yes, we do. In Zambia, we have what we call the Tax Policy Committee. So this Tax Policy Committee comprises of Minister of Finance officials, ZRA officials, and also these other officials. So we meet, like, during this period when we are about to present the budget. So there are these meetings that are taking place where we are exchanging notes and ensuring that whatever budget changes that are made, there is some sort of consensus among the major stakeholders. So thank you to Lanfe.
Thanks very much. I'm glad you highlighted that case. I think I know, I'm quite familiar with the taxpayer. In fact, they used to be my employer, so I'm quite, I do understand the merits of that case. But you are right in saying that there needs to be that constant engagement with the judiciary, and thank you for bringing that into this discussion. Shelton, would you like to add to that, please? Thanks.
Sure, thanks to Lani. Maybe just to add, tax incentives are not the major contributor to IFFs. As pointed out by my colleague here, the area of transfer pricing and tax planning is where most of the revenues are lost in Africa. It's complex, and developed nations have been at it for a long time, and they know the loopholes within our systems. The capacity within our jurisdictions is still quite low, and they are simply exploiting those weaknesses within our systems. So that's the area where we probably need to work more on, in ensuring that there is capacity within our jurisdictions to tackle these issues. And what I've also noticed within Africa is that there's this start-stop kind of arrangements within our jurisdictions when it comes to these capacity building initiatives. By now, we should be having within our authorities very vibrant, maybe transfer pricing or auditors who are able to detect this tax planning. But because of a lot of movements that happen within our jurisdictions, you'll find that the capacity is not where it is expected to be at this present moment after the years of training which has happened. And this is because you'll find that when capacity is built in some of these administrations, it is sort of like bought out or brought out of the administrations, and they become tax planners on the other side of the table. And within the administrations, you have novices in this. And so we need to put in place robust systems that ensure that whatever capacity has been inbuilt in the system is maintained or is passed on. Should anybody leave the authority, then that capacity is retained within. In addition to that, I've also noticed that another weakness that we have in as far as tackling the transfer pricing issue, which I believe is the elephant in the room, is the issue to do with our double taxation agreements. Just as the law, which Tulani pointed out, we have agreements that are sort of like archaic. Industry has been changing, the way business is done has been changing a lot, but we have agreements that are still governing us on conditions that were existing, say, 25 years ago. So what we need to do is to ensure that we have a system in place which allows us to renegotiate these agreements and ensure that we close any gaps that have arisen over the years. Turning to the issue of the capacity of our judiciary system when it comes to issues to do with tax incentives. Honestly speaking, my experience in that area is that the judiciary may not really be the problem. I would like to agree with Leila that the real weakness in the system is the policies behind. When these issues are done, you'll find that something is put in place which is legally binding. And so when that is brought before a court, the court has very little space to move. Yes, they may be seeing it that it may not be very beneficial to the country to have that kind of arrangement. But what's there for them to sort of like reverse something which has been legislated, so to speak, through a contract? So I agree with Leila that we need to have people that push, even civil society pushing, that we should have policies in place. This also addresses the issue to do with whether there is enough consultation or research when these tax incentives are then instituted. If we have policies that determine the way we act or the way these tax incentives are put in place and which express the desires of the people in that society, it will curb the abuse that is arising from from these tax incentives. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Shelton. You've really highlighted some very crucial areas. I mean, on the DTA, outdated double tax agreements, I think maybe now it's time for countries to perhaps start thinking about the UN Article 12A and 12B, because these are designed to specifically tax digitalized businesses. 12B is, you know, if you've got Article 12B in your treaty, you can probably confidently get some of that revenue from Amazon and Google, Booking.com and the like. And of course, you know, the issue about legalities is quite important. Ladies and gentlemen, I have some questions from our online participants, which I would like assistance from our technical team in allowing our colleagues who are joining us online to pose their questions.
So can I read one question from Winfred Miner? I would like to ask the opinion of the panelists of whether tax incentives are a governance issue or a policy issue. If a country has good governance structure, are tax incentives an issue, or are they properly utilized as a tool for development?
Yeah, thank you. I'm going to quickly take two questions from the floor, and then we're going to answer and then wrap up. The gentleman over here, thank you.
Mine is not a question. I was listening to the members, and you tried to highlight of the revisiting the penalties, but from the experience of the issues related to tax incentives is the failure to align the tax incentives within the domestic laws. You find that, like in Uganda, we have tax incentives in the tax laws, but also we have tax incentives in the investment code. So you find that each code is fighting to give incentives because we are capital importers. The other issue is to me, I think tax incentives are not bad in one way or the other, but harmful tax incentives. To me, I'm going to give my perspective on that. Currently, even have failed to find a vaccine on COVID-19 in Africa. In case we have a challenge and we need to award the tax incentives where we don't have the ability to, I think to me it is not a problem, but the problem is how would we manage? Uganda as a country is coming up with a tax expenditure governance framework. Can we have a civil society tax expenditure governance framework of our own where we can propose the areas where we think that any incentives can be given, provided you can be in position to fulfill what we want? To me, I think we need to revisit the relevance of the tax incentives vis-a-vis how we consider it. I thank you.
Thank you very much. I've got my sister there. Please go ahead.
Okay, thank you. My name is Penelao from Namibia. I think I just wanted to give some more information in terms of the question which was asked. Whether tax incentives are the main driver. I think there is work which Alan Mukungu has mentioned yesterday from UNECA, which involves 11 pilot countries. So while those reports are yet to be finally published, I think I just wish to attempt to give that when you are looking at the four typologies of illicit financial flows, you find there is import under invoicing, import over invoicing, export under invoicing, and import again over invoicing. So to answer the question is, we find that in the studies that the 11 countries have done, you find that entities are under invoicing their imports so that they evade whatever tariff the government has put there, and they also want to shift money abroad. At the same time, they will over invoice their import so that they will reduce the revenue or the sales that they need to account for in their financial statements. And by so doing, they would want to pay less corporate tax. Thirdly, they would want to under invoice their exports again so that they will reduce the sales revenue that needs to come in. But I think also to our surprise, even though there is also incentive in the other areas, you find that for the mineral-rich companies, the main problem is the export over-invoicing. And then we are then seeing that some of the drivers is where you have royalties that are allowed as deductions, and also where you have other exploit regimes where these entities need to claim certain rebates, maybe within their import cost. So out of the whole study, you find that up to 98% of the IFFs are then being driven through export invoicing, which presumably one can argue that the main driver could be some of the incentives. But at the end of the day, these entities, it looks like they simply don't want to pay whatever higher tax you have. If it's on the corporate side, that's what they are going to not want. But if you have lower tax, say the export levy, the custom duties, which is just 1 or 2%, they can happily pay there or over present so that they will come and claim it where it matters. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks very much. A very interesting point you're making. I suppose when you look at exporters and importers, that there's always a motivation to reduce the corporate income tax through those schemes. Thanks for highlighting that. Last question from the floor is going to Morenzi. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ephraim from ETAF. I was happy to hear that with the Ugandan case, so a situation whereby after the annual judges conference, URA is now able to win most of the cases. But my also case also emanates from the fact that we have to be careful because judges are there to uphold the rule of law. If the laws that were passed have got loopholes, or if the contracts signed are weak, definitely judges will always rule in favor, whether of a taxpayer or tax administration. So I think at a formative stage, we must look at our code of conduct in terms of the investment code. We must look at the parliament where the laws are passed or legislated. So by the end of the day, judges will look at the constitution. So my just point is that while we have to engage the judges from the start, we have to make sure that laws, regulations, contracts are tight, are well done in a such a way that the taxpayers will not exploit the weaknesses and the gaps. Thanks.
Yeah, thanks very much, Ephraim. I suppose this is it's like a chicken and egg discussion. Do you first implement a strong regulatory framework so that contracts are strong in nature so that judges can follow the nature of the contract? Or do you try and fix the judgment after and, you know, worry about the contractual obligation, redoing those contractual obligations later? Colleagues, let me ask the panelists to answer the question. I'm going to ask Leila if you can tackle the question from Wilfred around whether tax incentives are a governance issue or a policy issue.
So thanks, Solani. Really, really engaging discussions that have been taking place. I think in my view, I see tax incentives both as a governance issue and also as a policy issue. Because number one, the normative underpinning of tax incentives, they have to be based on policy, right? Policy is essential, based on which then law can be characterized in how we want to design our tax incentives regime. So if we don't have a policy strong enough to deal with tax incentives, then it becomes a policy issue. It's also a governance issue because if we really do not have proper functioning monitoring and evaluation systems in place, you know, through which government is able to assess the cost and benefit of the revenue foregone as a result of these tax incentives, then it is a sort of a governance issue, because it can lead to bad decisions, and bad decisions would then lead to a surge of multinational corporations that come in, structured in such a way through which they would utilize the tax incentives that are being offered to engage in or even foster aggressive tax planning. So yes, it's both a governance issue, and at the same time, it's also a policy issue. Back to you, Tulani.
Thanks very much, Leila. Colleagues, any last inputs that you'd like to add based on the questions and just closing off our discussion? I'll start with Shelton.
Thank you. Yes, tax incentives are both a governance issue and a policy issue, just like Leila said. And I believe the comments that came from the floor here demonstrate that. They are a policy issue when we don't have policies that are actually addressing the problem. Where we have problems, where these issues go to the courts, and the courts are bound, they can't do anything because there's no policy to direct their actions. And the public sees as if the courts are bought, so to speak. But if there is no policy which is tight enough to ensure that the aspirations of the people are there, are contained in the policy, they become a policy issue. Their governance issue, there's a lady who said, and I believe a gentleman as well, who said there are tax incentives that are put in place through blatant disregard of the law. That becomes a governance issue. So they have both these characteristics. Maybe just to add, another aspect to this is we may need to have, because of the complexity of some of these issues, to have special courts that are set or that are in place with judges that deal specifically with these tax matters. The risk is very huge for an incorrect judgment in courts. The losses that a nation can suffer from this are very huge. So there is need to have deliberate policies that ensure that there are special courts that are designed to deal with these issues. Thank you.
Martin, any last thoughts?
Yes, my last remarks would be that we need to encourage countries, most countries that have been part of these discussions concerning Pillar 1 and also Pillar 2. The advice is that countries should not shy away from being part of these discussions which are currently going on. Because it is through these discussions that we will be able to bring to the table the things that we do not agree with. For example, when we, through these engagements with the OECD and other major countries, we've been able to, and also through ATAF as well, we've been able to ensure that extractives have been excluded from Pillar 1. So it is only through these discussions that we've been able to achieve that. So imagine if we're not part of these discussions, then we wouldn't have achieved anything. The other issue that I would like to encourage countries, ensure that we need to advocate the formation of transfer pricing units, because this is what is happening in most of the countries. Multinationals are using these transfer pricing schemes, such as interest stripping, excessive management fees, excessive royalties, to base erode the taxation base of most countries. So there's need to counter those schemes by ensuring that transfer pricing units are formed in each jurisdiction. And then we also need to ensure that we collaborate with the organizations like ATA, for example, who have played a very important role, especially in Zambia, where now we are able to have officers who are highly skilled and are able to tackle these transfer pricing audits. Then we also need to advocate for legislative changes to our domestic tax laws, more especially to do with the introduction of safe harbor provisions, because safe harbor provisions have really helped countries that do not have capacity and also countries that do not have resources. If they are able to introduce these safe harbor provisions, such as, for example, in Zambia, we have one provision which we have introduced on sale of copper. So for every sale of copper in Zambia, the price at which the entity should declare is the price, the LME price. So that is our safe harbor provision. So a company will not disclose any other price apart from the LME price. Then there are also other provisions such as the low value services that are provided by these related party companies within the group. So if you are able to introduce a legislation that will limit the amount of a charge in terms of management fees through these provisions such as the safe harbor provisions, then you will see that most companies, they will only be, they will not be stripping profits through these illicit financial flows. So those could be some of the issues that we could tackle, and also if we could strengthen our legislation, then you will see that there will be more voluntary disclosures, more companies will come on board and voluntarily disclose any undeclared profits to the tax authorities. So those have been our experiences as Zambia to ensure that we close these gaps that are inherent in our legislation. Thank you, Tulani.
Thank you very much, Martin. Thank you, Shelton. Thank you, Leila. Most importantly, thanks to the colleagues online and here for your participation in our panel, for the discussion, for the questions you've raised, the suggestions, the input you've made, and certainly we're taking these on board in terms of thinking about more strategies in mobilizing domestic resources. We've come to the end of our session, and I hope you've thoroughly enjoyed it as much as we have. And also, I think if anyone is looking for a thesis topic, please consult Madame Shabalala, because that is a very interesting question. And I think we can do some statistical analysis on the correlation. If you know, I know my friend Robert is quite good with regression analysis, so there you go. Warm up your Stata program so that you can do that analysis. But thank you very much, colleagues, and I'm going to hand over to my colleague, Francis, who'll take us through the next steps.
You know, I am not really satisfied until I see everyone clapping. Yes, because I think Shelton, Martin, Leila, and Tulani did a great job. And we also got to hear more voices from the room, and we are really grateful for that. We will be heading into our health break, as well as the tea break. The tea break will run for 30 minutes. So now that we are breaking at 10:45, the tea break will be done by 11:15. We will then reconvene for the breakaway sessions. We will not require you to come back into the room if you will be proceeding to the other breakaways. I just want to recap that we have three breakaways. We have one that is organized by the Global Alliance for Tax Justice that will be interrogating more of the OECD tax deal and why developing countries need to say no to that deal. It will be happening in this room. And then we have another breakaway that is organized by South African Resource Watch. It will be happening in the INSACA room. INSACA room is the room that is on the right-hand side near the reception area. So once you go past the reception area, the breakaways that we were using yesterday, there's one that is on the right-hand side, the one that is bigger. We have a marker indicated on the door. And then we have another breakaway organized by, the South African Resource Watch breakaway will be looking at leveraging regional integration to address the multiple crises, what we've been discussing here. And then we have a last session. Southern African Resource Watch, SARWA. And then we have the last one organized by ETAF that will be looking at automatic exchange of information. It will be happening in the club lounge. And so where we have the registration desk, right outside that door, you head further up. That's where the club lounge will be. And as always, our volunteers will be at hand to help with finding the session you want to attend. For our online participants, if you check your comments section, we have given you links because we will be live streaming all the three sessions. So for those that want to attend the session on the OECD two-pillar proposal, you remain on the same link. But if you will be joining the one that is organized by either ETAF or the South African Resource Watch, SARWA, the links to join those sessions are available on your comments section. So we want to invite you to now have your tea as well as a health break. But immediately after that, please join the session. The sessions will run from 11:15. And then we will go for our lunch at 12:30. So the organizers of the sessions, 12:30 will be the hard stop, so that we come back into this room for the last session of the day at 1:30. I am informed that those that will arrive at exactly 1:30 will be entered into a book that will get you a gift at the end of the day. So make sure to be here at 1:30. And we are very serious with the offers that we make. So if you get here at 1:30, we can promise you before you leave, you will get a present at the end of the day today. So thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Let's see you back here at 1:30.
Happy yellow.